So good morning to all of you. This is the presentation on, you can say, the video on magnetic dipoles, inductance and torque. That is the last topic that I have to discuss in your class, in the course of electromagnetics. And this is the video regarding, as I've been repeating again, the magnetic dipoles, inductance and torque. So moving ahead, as you already know that there are two types of charges. There are stationary charges, there are moving charges, and we already know that in our part of magnetostatics we have to study with the charges that are in motion, because we have already discussed that stationary charges are nothing, will be having a constant electric field and will be useful for the electrostatics, but the moving charges will be useful for the creation of or for the constant magnetic field, and that will be responsible for magnetostatics. I hope that for now you are already knowing the relation between the electric displacement and electric field intensity. That is nothing but D is equal to epsilon E, where you can see the relation the static electric fields characterized by E or D are related accordingly as D equal to epsilon E, where epsilon is nothing but the relative, or you can say permittivity. It is nothing but the permittivity. It can be relative, it can be absolute. Similarly, on that pattern only, in the static magnetic fields also, we are having the relation of B and H as B is equal to mu into H. This relation we have already derived, and you have already used this relation for the certain amount of derivations. So the two major laws that will be also responsible for the calculation of magnetic dipoles, moment and torque or force, you can say, is nothing but the Biot-Savart law and Ampere-Circuital law. Again, on the analogy base, we can say that as you already know that Gauss law is nothing but the special case of Coulomb's law. So on that pattern only, Ampere's law is nothing but the special case of Biot-Savart law, because we have already discussed that by using n number of application, we can use Ampere's law for the derivation. We will not go for the Biot-Savart law, because Ampere's law is nothing but the special case of Biot-Savart law. So we have to discuss the magnetic properties. The magnetic properties are nothing but the magnetic dipoles. Dipoles will be nothing but which is having two polarity. So as you know, the electric dipole, that is nothing but the positive charge and negative charge. So on that pattern only, magnetic dipoles is nothing but the north pole and south pole. So north pole and south pole combinedly will going to form a magnetic dipole. What will be the field of a magnetic dipole? The force on a dipole on non-uniform field and induced magnetic dipole moment. We have to calculate a magnetic dipole moment. Again, little bit brush up for the Biot-Savart law. The Biot-Savart law is nothing but the current that is moving electric charges, which will going to produce a magnetic field. There are no magnetic charges. There will be moving electric charges. So that is the important point that you have to remember. That is nothing but the moving electric charges. It will not be having a moving magnetic charges. There will be nothing that is known as magnetic charges. So again, repeating that statement, the Biot-Savart law relates magnetic fields to the currents which are their sources. In a similar manner, Coulomb's law relates electric fields to the point charges which are their sources. So again, repeating the formula, that is nothing but B is equal to mu naught Idl cross R upon 4 pi R square. R will be nothing but the distance at which that point P, where we have to calculate the intensity of magnetic field. At which we have to calculate the intensity of magnetic field. Okay, moving ahead. Again, the formula or the value of mu naught, you already know that mu naught is nothing but 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7 Tesla meter upon ampere. So you can also write it as Henry per meter. You can also write it as Weber upon ampere into meter. Different units are available. You always have to remember these units and this value, because it will be highly required for solving of any numerical. Simple, if you are having a circular current loop, as you can see there are two loops. One loop is at the bottom and another loop is at the top. Now you have to calculate the magnetic field B at a point P due to the big loop. So as you can see that there will be a flow of current in a circular loop. At a r distance you can see red mark, it is nothing but the magnetic field. So using Biot-Savart law or Ampere's circuit law, you can calculate that B is equal to mu naught I upon 2 capital R square upon R square plus Z square ki power 3 by 2, where this expression R square plus Z square ki power 3 by 2 is coming. If you are calculating the distance of that small r, all of you see that slant line which is written as small r, that is small r distance from the big circular loop to that point P, it is nothing but the resultant of small z and capital R. It is nothing, I am again repeating, that is the distance between the big circular loop to that point P, where dB is marked, that is nothing but the change in magnetic field. That small r distance is nothing but the resultant of small z and capital R. That can be written as, by using Pythagoras theorem, we can write small r is nothing but under root of z square plus capital R square. And we already know that the ratio of the distance according to Biot-Savart law is nothing but mu idl cross r upon r square, r cube. So that r cube is the distance, and this r cube distance over here is r square plus z square ki power 1 by 2. So 1 by 2 into 3 will be nothing but r square plus z square ki power 3 by 2. Okay. Again, similarly, the circular current loop that we have already derived, if z is very large than capital R, so what I want to convey is, if that circular current loop, big circular current loop radius is very much less, as we have to as compared to that point P where we have to calculate the value of magnetic field intensity. So if z, the distance z, is much greater than capital R, we can have the changes in the formula, or that formula can be reduced to capital B is equal to mu naught I upon 2 capital R square upon z cube. This can be rewrite as mu naught upon 2 pi I pi R square upon z cube. We have multiplied pi in the numerator and we have also divided it by pi to make it constant. So again we can say that the magnetic dipole, we have to remember this formula. I am not going much deeper in the derivation part. You should remember this formula. This formula can be asked in examination. Explain magnetic dipole moment. You have to write this formula and write something about the magnetic dipole moment. So nothing, by using that reduction in the formula, we have derived one important formula, that is nothing but capital B is equal to mu naught upon 2 pi z cube into mu, where mu is nothing but pi r square into I. Let's go back to that slide. You again know that this mu pi r square upon z cube, if I am writing I pi r square is equal to mu, so where mu is pi r square into I, as comparing with that previous equation, this mu that is equal to pi r square into I is nothing but magnetic dipole moment. Where mu and b are in the same direction. So it should be again the good conceptual question that magnetic dipole moment direction and the magnetic field intensity direction should be on the same direction. It should be having same direction. Again, I'm repeating that both magnetic dipole moment and your magnetic field intensity should be having a same direction. Okay, moving ahead a little bit. Now we have to calculate the torques and forces on a magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. A magnetic dipole is nothing, you are already knowing that if you are having a magnet and that magnet is kept in the area which is having a constant current or constant magnetic field, it will start experiencing a force, because you already studied about something about the TDCM course, that is DCMT course. You already know the working of a DC machine, that if current carrying conductor is placed in the vicinity of a magnetic field, it will start experiencing a force. that force is nothing but due to the Fleming's left hand rule, or either by Fleming's right hand rule. So you already know those concepts. Those concepts only will be utilized over here for the calculation of torque and force on nothing but on a magnetic dipole. The dipole is nothing but north and south pole combinedly, as you have already studied in the electrostatics. The electric dipole is nothing but the combination of plus Q and minus Q. Okay, so again repeating, a magnetic dipole is nothing but it will going to experience a torque in a magnetic field. So let's start calculate torque on a rectangular current loop in a uniform field B. Suppose in this figure you can see that this is your regular, or you can say uniform magnetic field, in which we have marked some rectangular infinitesimal smaller, very much small rectangles, that is nothing but we have to, that is on that we have nothing, we have to calculate a you can say torque. So now, as we have talked about the torque on a rectangular, we can say that torque on a rectangular current loop we have to calculate, that is on a uniform field B. As you can see, current I is flowing. We have already assumed smaller, very much small size rectangles of having uniform magnetic field B. So the formula that we will be arriving, or we will be using, or will the concept we will be using is nothing but, let's suppose this is your plane, this is your plane plate, in which is placed in XYZ coordinate system, in which M, let B is the direction of magnetic field intensity in the direction of capital Z. And the forces on the two vertical sides cancels, they tend to stretch the loop that don't rotate it. So now you can see that if you are assuming this particular rectangular sheet in a very thin rod in the right hand side diagram, you can see if B force is acting in the direction of Z, due to the force B and as current is flowing through that particular rod, it will start experiencing a force along due to on the basis of Fleming's left hand rule, and it will start to rotate. That rod will start to rotate, but it will not rotate. It will not rotate only and only if on the both the edges there will be equal and opposite force. What is the line written in this slide? The forces on two vertical sides cancel each other. They tend to stretch the loop, but they don't rotate it. What will happen? There are, you can see two F. One is acting on a rod at the top end, and one F is acting on the rod at the bottom end. But both these forces will going to stretch the rod or stretch the loop, but it will not going to rotate it. That is nothing but the, you can say it is in the equilibrium position. So moving ahead, again you can say that if the normal vector, that is which is placed at an angle of theta with the magnetic field intensity, the force, effective force that you have already studied the formula, that is nothing but the IB, or b, small b is nothing but the length of the rod. You can also write b with as small l also. So I small b into capital B sine 90 plus theta into x direction. So you always know that F will be acting in the direction of x axis. The force F will be acting in the direction of x axis. So this formula is also very important. You have to remember this formula, that the effective force acting on a particular rod which is placed at an angle of theta, and the norm which is placed at an angle of theta, it means that the normal vector is forming an angle theta with magnetic field B. So we can say that the force effective will be IBB sine 90 plus theta. So let's suppose that normal vector is theta is equal to 90 degree, or theta is equal to 0 degree. So IBB sine 90 will be maximum. So if your rod is placed along the y direction, that n cap theta angle, that n cap theta angle will be 0 degree, and as that it will be 0 degree, so this theta will be 0 degree, and your formula will be going to become IBB sine 90 in the direction of x cap, and that will be maximum because sine 90 is having a maximum value. Similarly, so what we have to find, we have to find a torque. So torque can be only find if we are having a force. So we have calculated a force. So the force and the that force is acting on which direction, on which radial vector, that will going to give us the torque. So torque formula is nothing but R cross F. What is R? R is the radial vector at which your torque will going to be applied. So let's say we have to calculate the torque. So we, in that two torques have been calculated, one is tau R and another is tau L. So your tau R is nothing but I, that is on the top end of the particular rod, that is nothing but IAB B by 2 sine theta x cap, and tau left will be IAB B by 2 sine theta x cap. Why it is B by 2? B by 2 because there will be two types of torque, one will be acting downwards and one will be acting upwards, so that it will be stretching the particular loop, but it will not going to rotate it. But let's suppose tau L is somehow equal to zero, then tau R will be only left, and due to that tau R it will start rotating. But as you can see in this formula, the tau R and tau L both are equal, as they both are equal, so they will going to cancel out each other. So net torque will be equal to zero. So as net torque will be equal to zero, so again we can say that there will be no rotation, it will be only resulting in the stretch of a particular loop. So how, what is this R? R is nothing but the perpendicular distance. You have already studied about the work done in the mechanical portion in your rotational mechanics. So torque is nothing but the force into perpendicular distance. The force you have already calculated, that is I small b capital B into sine 90 plus theta or sine theta, and you have to just multiply the perpendicular distance. So as you can see, this force is acting, so the perpendicular distance from the origin is nothing but the b by 2. So this b by 2 will be multiplied over here. So you can say that IAB into B by 2 sine theta, which is acting in the direction of x cap. So that will going to give you the force, that will going to give you the torque of a particular, torque on a particular magnetic dipole. Okay. These are also a formula for a particular torque on a current loop. So let's suppose if they are having a current loop, then torque will be IAB B sine theta. And if you are having a torque at, and that IAB sine theta, it is nothing but your AB is being kept inside that capital A. So torque formula is nothing, which is very important, that is nothing but NIA into N cap into B vector. What is N? It is in, N is the number of turn, I is the current, A is the area of a loop, N cap is the normal vector of that particular loop, and B is nothing but a magnetic field intensity. So from here you can say that IAB is nothing but a force, and NIN cap is nothing but that R vector which is acting along that particular loop in a direction of 90 degree. So this is a very important topic from your point of view. So this PPT is quite enough. I have already shared you the PPT. This is the video that I am sharing with you all, which will be having a particular explanation of each of the slides. If you are having any amount of doubt, you can mail me and we can clear those doubts, and that is the topic that is required to be explained in the class. But as due to the ongoing pandemic situation, I am delivering this video to you all. So be calm, be safe, stay at your homes and keep studying. Okay, thank you.